Hi, this is Graham from Jenham's Astro. In this video, I'm going to do an experiment. I'm going to try using this Celestron F6.3 focal reducer corrector, which is normally designed to be used with a Smith-Cass grain telescope like this one. I'm going to try and use it for imaging with this, a 127 Maksutov telescope. Now, if you think that might be of interest and you haven't already subscribed to Jenham's Astro, then please click the button and let's see how this experiment goes. Okay, so back to basics before we actually do any of the tests, but what is this device? So the 6.3 reducer corrector from Celestron. Now, there's a bit of controversy, a lot of discussion online at least, about what the corrector element of the name suggests. Now, a lot of people say that it is actually correcting for coma, so that the sort of cone-shaped effect that you can get with stars as you go off axis should be reduced with one of these. And other people say, well, maybe it's actually a flattener device, so that it's going to change the field curvature so that the image is in focus across the whole focal plane. Now, devices like scopes like Smith-Cassegrain suffer from coma as well as a lot of field curvature, whereas Maksutovs have much less of that. They have a flatter field naturally because they use a different shape corrector lens than the one in the Smith-Cassegrain. So basically, If I don't get into what's actually true about whether this is correcting for coma or flattening, what I'm trying to determine is if I use a device like this, designed for this type of telescope, in one of these, is it going to introduce more problems than it solves in terms of optical quality? Now, because I'm not probably smart enough to fully understand all the ray tracing and all the optical elements that are in play here, I'm simply going to try it. And I'm going to try it using a digital SLR. So basically, you're going to take the 127. I've already attached an adapter thread because, as you might have seen in my short video, I've had to adjust that so that it takes the SCT thread. After that, I'm going to put the reducer on, and then I'm going to use my Canon 700D. Now, this is a cropped sensor camera. It's an APS-C camera sensor, so it's not a full frame sensor, which is a factor we'll come to a bit later on, but nonetheless we're going to have a look and see what kind of images we get when I use this scope with the reducer and the camera versus using it without the reducer. So one more thing before we get started, it's always worth mentioning that spacing is important when using any kind of reducer, corrector, flattener device. So in this case, Celestron recommend that you should have a distance of 105 millimeters between the lens at the back of the corrector reducer and the sensor within your camera. So I'm using a T adapter, which is a model 93633, which is a standard T adapter that you'd use to connect up DSLR onto the back of your SCT. So when I use this adapter with the reducer, it's all worked out quite nicely so that you have the right separation. Basically, I think there are 44 millimeters of distance between the flange on the front of this EOS DSLR and the sensor chip. And then the T-ring is adding around 10 millimeters. And then the adapter is adding just over 50 millimeters. So if we add all that together, it gets us to the 105 millimeters. Now I'm going to start with this. I'm not going to vary that, although I'm aware that changing that spacing will adjust the effective focal reduction that we're getting, but I'm just going to use the setup that was recommended using the standard adapter, no extra spaces or anything else like that. So, okay, that's the setup. Let's have a look at what we get with this arrangement, with and without the reducer. Okay, so the first thing I did was take the camera and the telescope outside during the day, and I took a frame with the camera just looking up at the sky, and you can see here that it's evenly illuminated. This is a crop sensor camera, but basically it's all the same level of illumination throughout the frame. And then I fitted the reducer, and you can see around those corners there's quite a lot of vignetting. They're not full illumination of the field of view, and this is what you expect with a reducer function. It's squeezing the output from the back of the telescope into a smaller angular range in order to allow you to see what's outside of that range, but it means that you don't get full illumination. So this is something to look out for when we get onto looking at night sky viewing. So that reducing function most obvious target, always the moon. Now, the moon itself fits quite nicely into the field of view of this telescope and camera setup. We've got around about just over half a degree vertical angular size on the frame. So I can fit the field of view, the whole moon, no problem, without any reducing. But if we do fit the reducer, you can see the moon is now surrounded by much more blackness, lots of space. And obviously in this case, you can't really see, you can't tell the difference between the black background and a loss of illumination. But the reducing function certainly works pretty well. As for correcting, so basically what I did here is I put the scope onto my Vixen AP mount, and it took a series of 30 second frames at ISO 1600 just to see what the image quality was like. And I pointed at the Pleiades, a Messier 45. Pretty early on, when I started to look at a couple of the subs, I noticed some strange effects. You can see down here that, especially if you look down at the lower right or the upper left, some strange arcs of light emanating from these bright stars. It's not visible from the star in the middle of the field, but this was something strange going on. So even though we can fit the whole of the Pleiades into the field, which is good for reducing, something strange was happening. I was a little worried that my reducer corrector was actually faulty. So what I did then was I decided to fit, that you can fix this sort of field illumination aspect to that problem. You can see around the edge of the vignetting, you can fix that with flat frames pretty easily. So there you go. But it doesn't detract from the fact that we've got these strange arcs. So what I did was then I took my 5-inch, my C5, Celestron C5 SCT, and put the reducer straight onto the back of that to see whether these artifacts were visible with the SCT. And you can see here that we fit the Pleiades into the field of view, slightly different image scale because the focal lengths of the two telescopes are a little bit different, but we don't see any strange effects. And after the 30 exposures, we're starting to see a little bit of nebulosity coming through. So this told me straight away that the reducer seems to work okay, but when I fit it onto the Mac, some strange things are happening. So then I already had the C5 on the scope, so I moved on to another target. So I pointed the scope at the Orion Nebula and took a shot with the C5 and the reducer corrector. And yeah, pretty nice image. It just lets you see more of the frame, as you might expect, and quite good rendering of the stars. A little bit of aberration at the edge. So it's not perfect, but it works pretty well with the C5. But then it went straight back to the 127, and you can see the bright star again near the edge here on the right. We've got that arc of some sort of distorted light. Now, I'm not sure whether this is an overcorrection, because like I said, you don't need to correct the max field, and we are doing that with the reducer corrector, but certainly I don't like that artifact over there over on the right. And then finally took the 127 back to its native focal ratio to f12, and obviously we are shrunken in here to seeing less sky, if you like, but we're not seeing any artifacts. So that's what we get just with the 127 on its own. So my conclusions from this experiment, which only uses one telescope, one Mac and one SCT, and it uses one reducer corrector. So I would say that for imaging, the answer probably is no. That distortion was pretty awful. I think the fact that it worked on the C5 suggests that it's not a faulty reducer, and it's just the fact that we're trying to use an inappropriate device with the Mac. So I don't think this is a way of making your F12 Mac much quicker and using it for imaging. As for visual, well, vignetting isn't too noticeable. You're not too sensitive to it in the way that you are when you're taking long exposure with imaging. Couldn't see the arcs visibly that we picked up when we took those longer subs. But still, the stars weren't pinpoint. I really didn't like them. There was some distortion throughout the field of view, and they weren't nice pinpoints. So what I'd say in summary is that if you've got a reducer corrector already for your SCT, then use it. I think it's a great device, and certainly with my C5 and my C8, it is really nice. It's a lot of fun, and you do actually get a benefit from it. So definitely for visual with an SCT, and probably for imaging as well, I haven't done it, I recommend the reducer corrector. But if you've got a Mac, certainly like this 127, I think you should stick with its native focal ratio. Put up with its narrow field of view, because when you use it in that configuration, the field is wonderfully sharp and you get lots of contrast. So I hope it's been a useful video. It's following on from videos I've seen from some of my Astro friends like Garnet Leary. So I hope this is built on that and given a few of you some ideas who've wondered whether you could do a miracle transformation on your Mac into a faster scope. So I would say a little bit of caution there. So thanks for watching, and please look out for more videos from Jenham's Astro. Bye for now.